Hello everyone, welcome to the Geoecologist. I'm Dr. Krishnanand, and in this session, we are going to learn about the contributions of various scholars in the American School of Geographical Thought. So we have already looked into the Western Europe and British School of Geographical Thoughts. Now it's time to look at the American School of Geographical Thought. What were the processes that helped in the formulation of various knowledge forms in geography, and who were the prominent geographers that we study today as well? So let's understand their contributions, but before we go ahead, please like and subscribe to our channel and don't forget to press the bell icon for the updates. So now, when we are looking at American School of Geographical Thought, let's understand one thing. That entire Western Europe that we see, largely the Germany, the French and the Britain, all were contemporaries in terms of establishment of geographical thought. So American School was also not far behind. As Western Europe and Americans were connected through various trades and commerce and exchange of knowledge, so American School of Thought also emerged at the same particular time that we see is the last part of 19th century. So let's understand what happened in the last part of 19th century in the establishment of American School of Geographical Thought. So, first scholar who has the greatest contribution in terms of making the association of American geographers and establishment of the School of Geographical Thought in America is William Morris Davis. So, we will study about him in details when we study geomorphology. So, in this we are only talking about his contributions in larger picture. So, he is also considered as father of American geography because he established the School of Geographical Thought in America, and especially his contribution in 1889 that we still study is the works that he did in terms of rivers and valleys of Pennsylvania. So this was his first important work in which he talked about sequential change in landscape through fluvial erosion. So Davis did not talk about structure, process or stage in his first work. He basically talked about sequential change in landscape. So that is important to remember, which was part of his article published in 1889. And with him being the first geographer coming from the geological background, geomorphology became one of the major pivots in terms of geographical thought in American School of Geography. Because the contribution of the first professor in American School of Geographical Thought, that is William Morris Davis, was in the fields of geology and geomorphology. So the physical geography in America became one of the prominent part of geographical thought. Now, let's understand furthermore, the modern term that we study, that base level, it was introduced during same time period almost by John Wesley Powell in 1875. So what we observe in 1889, Davis took this particular term and subsequently appropriated it in his cycle of erosion theory. So what we observe in his cycle of erosion, when we study that in details, that rise from upliftment from a base level and again it is lowered down to the base level in which erosional processes act. This base level was not originally Davis' concept. It was given by John Wesley Powell, okay, J.W. Powell. But he took that and worked out his own cycle of erosion theory, which became one of the most important theory in terms of the study of the landforms. So largely when we study the theory of landforms, we study W.M.Davis as one of the pioneers of the theories of development of landforms. Furthermore, his textbook, Elemental Physical Geography. So it was not just cycle of erosion or sequential change, but his work was termed Elemental Physical Geography, includes a chapter entitled Geographical Aid in Human Progress. So that is very interesting, that how he discussed about the physical geography of landscapes which influence the progress of man from the savage towards the civilized state. So largely we see here is the concept of determinism in his ideas, which was again coming from the Darwinian concept, which was there in 1859. It emerged, so it changed the way world thought at that time. So Davis's work, that was Elemental Physical Geography, was also of the same line of thought, that progress of human being is all dependent upon the physical nature. Nature determines. So this environmental determinism was one of the most important point in terms of the evolution of geographical thought in American School of Geographical Thought. Next scholar in line is Mark Jefferson. So he was a chief cartographer when American delegation was sent to Paris Peace Conference in 1919. So what we observe that he was also one of the heads of geography department at Michigan State Normal University. Now, earlier it was a college, now it's a university. So he wanted geography to emphasize on man on earth, not on earth and man. So remember, he focused on man. It means what we see here is, again, that Davis talked about physical earth, he talked about human beings. So Davis was largely following the school of determinism, while Mark Jefferson was talking about possibilism. So he was opposed to the systematic approach in geography, but favored some form of regional paradigm. So in terms of dichotomy, if we see, he was follower of a regional paradigm. He considered the concept of indeterminism, which was originally coined in Russia. So indeterminism was something which he worked and further attached his work more to importance to man's creativity, means man's creative ability to actually create or carve his niche in particular environment. So according to him, a country's leading city is always disproportionately. Now look at this concept. It is talking about human beings' creation, about city, about urban spaces. So he said that a country's leading city is always disproportionately large and exceptionally expressive of national capacity and feeling. It means he talked about the law of primacy. So this law of primate city was given by Mark Jefferson in during that particular time in 1930s. So he is supposed to be one of the pioneers of urban geography as well, and also the promoter of possibilism and regional paradigm in geography. Next important noteworthy scholar is coming from University of Yale. So he is known as Ellsworth Huntington. He is known for his studies on controversial science, a very interesting controversy that aroused through his work, that was ranking the races. He ranked various races from northwestern Europe, which were supposed to be at the top, and at the bottom he said that African races are inferior. So this superiority and inferiority of the races was one of the important things that he said in his work. Furthermore, he worked on environmental determinism, climatic determinism, economic growth, economic geography. So largely he was from the paradigm of determinism. So he talked about how climate, how space, how particular location determines the race. So supreme races are largely in the temperate zones of the world, if you observe. So that was his major concept. In his book Explorations in Turkestan in 1905 and Pulse of Asia in 1907, he attempted to correlate periods of drought and historical dates. So that is one important point, and in which he discussed about migration of people, especially nomadic peoples from Central Asia, which led to the Mongol conquests of India and China. And this was only happening because of, according to him, climatic determinism. As the land was dried up and pastures dried up, so these nomadic herders came to different parts of the world, and also the people from Mongol again started their conquests, who came from the Central Asia. So largely this conquests of Mongols has been given a view where climate determined their conquests. Then in his next book, Civilization and Climate, he formulated that man's civilization could only develop in regions of stimulating climate. So for him, everything was the determinism idea of climate. It meant physical parameters, climatic parameters determine the civilizations as well. So that is important. And his work that is called pragmatic determinism, that is practical determinism, appears to be very much in line with Griffith Taylor's stop and go determinism as well, and Anushin's, that is Russian's work of neo-determinism. So what we observe is that deterministic school of thought prevailed through the works of Ellsworth Huntington as well. So now, a very famous scholar, Ellen Churchill Semple. So what we have observed all throughout the German school of thought, French school of thought, British school of thought as well, we have not observed more of women protagonists. But she was one of the first women to become president of Association of American Geographers. So we see first major women contribution in the foundations of the modern geography in American school of geographical thought through the works of E.C. Semple. So her first book, American History and Its Geographic Conditions, came in 1903. And second, that is the most famous work, that was Influences of Geographic Environment, came in 1911. These were two major contributions of E.C. Semple that changed the way people looked in terms of the earth, the physical parameters, and the human parameters in American school of geographical thought. So she pointed out that man is a product of earth's surface, a child of the earth, dust of her dust, and entered into his bone and tissue, into his mind and soul. So according to her, earth's surface, the earth, the physical earth, the climate, the rock, the soil, all the physical parameters of the earth determine the being of humans itself. How human beings have evolved through the entire life processes, as supported by Darwin's concept, she also said the same thing, that earth has supported human beings to be in the way they are. So man is the product of earth's surface. That is asked in several examinations, that how we explain this particular statement. Simple described in her work that people and their associated landscapes are the dividing line for the world into key environmental types. So if we observe that key environmental types of the world, we'll observe different environments have different kinds of people, and they have a unique relationship with their associated landscape. So she talked about these four key ways. So remember these four key ways that physical environment impacts. So the first was direct physical effects of on human beings. That was climate and altitudinal effect. Second was psychical effects like culture, art, religion. So this also had an impact of the climate and the location of the world. Then economic and social development. This was also important, as it was related to the resources and livelihoods which come from the nature largely. And movement of people was according to the natural barriers, oceans, sea routes, land routes, which was important, such as mountain passes, river. So all these impactful factors she related to the human beings. So this is the four key factors of E.C. Semple. Another important scholar at that particular time is H.H. Barrows. Why he's an important figure in the early development of academic discipline of geography? Because his concept was of human ecology that he propounded. So concept of human ecology became increasingly famous, and his work that was The Elements of Geography with Salisbury and W.S. Tower became famous in terms of the concepts of human ecology. So he was one of the influential person who led to the shift in the development of field, which is mostly seen through the ecological lens. So largely he talked about the development of academic discipline of geography through the lens of ecology, through the lens of human ecology. That was important. So next scholar that we study in American School of Geographical Thought is Albert Perry Brigham. So he was one of the protagonists of the deterministic concept of division tradition, but with a slight difference. He did not say that climatic determinism is the absolute truth. He had that determinism is fine, but not absolutely. So he rejected exactly what? The climatic determinism. Rather than, he only talked about the determinism of land, basically about the landscape. So it was more of the land that determined, the soil, the location that determined in his work. So geographic influences in history, that is his work, was almost released at the same time with E.C. Semple's work. But Semple's work was talking about climatic determinism, whereas his work is talking about the landscape determinism. Then Roland D. Salisbury, the chairman of the Department of Geography at Chicago from 1903 to 1919 that we see, was skeptical about paradigm of determinism. So in his work, in Salisbury's work, so he rejected this idea of simple cause and effect relationship between physical earth and human response. Rather, he said that the relationship of the stage setting to human action was not a causal one simply. It means there were not just a cause and effect relationship, but multiple factors were related to the formation of a particular kind of human relationship with the nature. Next in the American School of Geographical Thought is Carlos Saar. So his possibilist movement that was started coming from the French School of Geographical Thought had a great influence on the works of Carlos Saar. So he was influenced by the concept of cultural landschaft, that is the cultural landscape. As we remember, the German geographer Otto Schlüter gave this concept, and further French School of Geographical Thought propounded by Vidal de la Blache about the possibilism. So this led to the development of the concept of cultural landscape further more by Carlos Saar, and He had been called the Dean of American Historical Geography as well for his works, and one of his best work is called Agricultural Origins and Dispersals that was published in 1952. But for major developments in cultural geography, in 1927, he wrote the Recent Developments in Cultural Geography. So he's also known as Father of Cultural Geography in Evolution of Geographical Thought. So Carl Sar's most important and most famous work in cultural geography is The Morphology of Landscape, in which he argues unambiguously that geography is the morphological study of cultural landscapes. So this was the definition given by Carl Sar. Another great scholar of American school of thought is Derwent Whittlesey. We remember his concept of sequent occupants of people. It means stepwise occupations of people in different parts of the world. So his view of geography as a succession of stages of human occupants, which establishes the genetic of each stage in terms of its predecessor, represents antithesis of environmental determinism. So he was an anti-environmental deterministic in nature of his work, and he said that the world is not just determined by climate, but it is majorly determined by the sequence of occupants. So he further divided the agricultural regions of the world into 11 different regions, and he gave its characteristics of the regions. And furthermore, his works on Problem of Our Time in 1946 and Environmentalism versus Geography, the most famous work in 1948, was published, where he rejected the paradigm of determinism. So he introduced the concept of compage region. This compage region is basically about the totality concept, not just the basic functionality concept, but the completeness in itself. So he was one of the perspective that if we combine some parts together, it will become a whole new area. For example, the states and union territories all together form a country. So he wanted to talk in terms of a complete whole, where he gave this concept of compage region. Means it was comprising of several smaller regions to form a bigger region. So a combination of few countries became a continent. Thus, compage region can be defined as regional geography, or a huge part of the area made by small structures, or in other words, a combination of many parts in a functional whole. So this was very interesting terminology given by Derwent Whittlesey. At the same time, one of the most important prominent scholars of American school of thought was Richard Hartshorne. So we remember him for the work of great caliber in terms of aerial differentiation, the concept that he propounded, The Nature of Geography, published in 1939, a critical survey of current thought in the light of the past. So he was one of the propounders of the regional geography about the aerial differentiation as a major work. So he was coming from the Hettner's idea of chorology and further propounder of this particular work, where he defined that what is the nature of geography. He gave an influential modern statement of geography as aerial differentiation, drawing from arguments of Hettner, and was published in his work that was Nature of Geography. According to him, concept of aerial differentiation in geography is about showing how unique regions reveal the covariance of phenomena that can only be understood through identifying those particular unique factors of these regions. But there was entirely a debate with another scholar that we know by the name of Scheffer. So he adopted a scientific method for the study of spatial laws. So he talked about lawmaking, about generalization on the basics of scientific method, and he contradicted Hartshorne's method. So we have a Hartshorne and Scheffer debate coming in this particular era in 1950s, which is very famous, because one, Scheffer said that geography is about scientific discipline, it's about scientific lawmaking, it's about generalization, whereas Hartshorne talked about aerial differentiation, about uniqueness in a particular region. So that was important to note here.
So now, when we have studied about the American school of geographical thought, we come to know that determinism and possibilism were the two larger paradigms under which all these scholars have been largely divided, or they have at least talked about regional differentiation, aerial differentiation, or spatial analysis as well. So we see, after the analysis of all these schools of thought like German, French, British, and American, that various branching of geographical knowledge happened as a field of advanced study in geography. So in the next lecture, we are going to learn about the contributions of Indian scholars Because we have seen the West, now it's time to see our own country, its contributions, the great scholars right from the ancient to the current era. What was their contribution in geographical thought and how geography emerged as a discipline in India. So all the best wishes. Stay safe. Stay tuned. Take care.